And while so, that's how quite a number of Irish people got to come. And while members of British Parliament were drafting and passing this Act, those keen to get it going were making their plans. These men were mainly dissenters. That is, they were Protestant Christians who belonged to religious bodies outside the established English or Scottish Church and the state or established churches of their homeland. And among them were Congregationalists, Baptists, Quakers and Methodists. In fact, according to one writer, there were 57 different brands of Protestantism represented in South Australia in the 1850s. So there were lots of these small groups. And these people were outside the mainstream of national life. They were less interested in systematic colonisation than in founding a colony where, with neither an established church or convicts, they might enjoy civil and religious freedom. That was their aim. But the education of the working classes was not on their agenda. And so until the years of 1828 to 32, the established churches had held a monopoly in matters religious in the British Isles. And so neither Catholics nor dissenters could hold public office of any kind. They couldn't be members of Parliament, they couldn't go to university or hold commission in the army, and they were all obliged to marry, baptise, be baptised in an Anglican church and be buried in an Anglican churchyard, regardless of their religious affiliation. And of course, the Industrial Revolution of the 18th century had upset the old social order and seen the emergence of a new middle class of increasingly wealthy industrialists. And many of these turned their backs on the established church. And they resented the limitations to their freedom strongly, and some of them were advocating total separation of church and state. So these people became actively involved in organising the settlement of South Australia, and they were determined that everyone should enjoy religious and political freedom. And one of their number, a gentleman named George Fyfe Angus, who really didn't like Catholics very much, but who nevertheless was a great colonist, he said it was a place to provide refuge for the pious dissenters of Great Britain who could, in their new home, discharge their consciences before God in civil and religious duties without any disabilities. So that was the aim of South Australia, that everybody who came, regardless of religious affiliation, would be treated equally. And as there was no government-supported state church, the founders set up what they called the voluntary system of support for religion. And education fell into that category too, and which was seen to be the work of the churches. So that under the voluntary system, the members of the church, each particular church, had to erect their own place of worship, support their own pastors, instruct their children in their faith, and if they could afford it, teach them to read and write. And so the white settlers who arrived in the colony in 1836 and those who followed comprised people from every part of the British Isles and even beyond. And they included Anglicans, Catholics, Presbyterians and Lutherans, as well as those many numerous Protestant groups. And many had very small groups, including the Catholics, and they could be counted in tens rather than hundreds. But at the same time, there was generally, in those early days, quite a strong deal of religious tolerance between the groups. They helped each other build their churches. They supported each other in various ways. There wasn't the bitterness that you find in New South Wales and Victorian history between Catholics and others in the early history. And then there was a small group of Catholics there. And in 1838, 2 years after settlement, the leader of the small group of Catholics, William Phillips, wrote to Bishop Poling in Sydney, and he was Bishop of all Australia at that time, requesting that he send a priest to celebrate Mass for them. Now, Paulding got that letter, but it was 2 years before a priest arrived. The first priest to go there was William Ullathorne. He said the first Mass in Adelaide in William Phillips's home on East Terrace. And when he came back to Sydney, he recommended to Paulding that he send a resident priest over here. Over to Adelaide, sorry, I think I'm home. To Adelaide. And so in 1841, the first resident priest, William Benson, arrived in Adelaide. But the people living in the country were dismayed because Benson couldn't ride a horse. So he was stuck in the city. And at the time, the colony had gone into recession, and his people, who were mainly labourers on low wages, well, they couldn't afford to support him very well, so he earned his living as a carpenter. He worked as a carpenter during the week, and on weekends he said Mass in the basement of a city shop. They had no buildings whatever. He was living in rented property. They just could not afford to pay anything more. But anyway, gradually more Catholic labourers arrived, mostly from Ireland. And that first lot who came were the famine. Quite a different set of characters than the ones who came after the famine. You know, they weren't in the same desperate situation. So they arrived, along with other new settlers. By 1844, they comprised about 8% of the population. 1 in 12 of the people in South Australia was Catholic. If you came to New South Wales and Victoria, it was 1 in 3. Quite a different situation. That year arrived Bishop Murphy. This small group, they sent a bishop there because the bishop in Paulding could never get there. So when Bishop Murphy, he encouraged his people to work in harmony with their Protestant neighbours. He spoke out quite strongly about it. And when he arrived, he had a staff of one priest. He had no church, no house, no school. But all wasn't lost, because Murphy came from New South Wales, where he'd been given people from Sydney had given him quite a substantial sum of money when he left, and he used that to buy a block of land in the city. Now, I found out a really interesting thing about Bishop Murphy when I was researching this, because he found it so different. Adelaide was so different from Sydney, where he'd been for the previous 6 years. And before he left Sydney, he addressed a meeting over there where he stated his belief that the system of education most agreeable to the wishes and most suitable to the wants of the Catholic community, which comprises 1/3 of the population, is one that will enable us, through the cooperation of the state, to give our children a sound, practical education, leaving to the parents, the natural guardians, and to the pastors, the appointed instructors, to determine the circumstances of time, place, and manner in which religious instruction should be imparted. No mention of Catholic school. The parents were to be the teachers, which is what we've been trying to do more recently.